And when God was saying, Adam, where are you? I remember one of our fathers in the Lord, Pastor E.S. Famuide. We hosted him then at our church. And he was describing man and describing the fall of man. He said, when the Lord asked Adam, where are you? It looked like Adam was not in the shape that God had left him. And he described it with a mirror. When you look at yourself in a mirror, you see the reflection of who you truly are. You see your image, your beauty. And then if you take a stone or pebble and you strike the mirror and it cracks, into different parts. And when you stand before the same mirror, your head becomes bigger. Your nose becomes double. Your body becomes larger. You're not the true shape that you are because of the cracks that you have in the mirror. So Adam was no longer in the position that God left him. And I now began to expound that and look at it this way, more deeply, that when God said to Adam, Adam, where are you? Every time God asks you such questions, you are in for trouble. The God who knows all things, the omnipotent, omniscient God, omnipresent God, is everywhere at the same time. Where Adam was hiding, God was there. God could see him from where he was as God, and God was there where he was as God. Now, for God to ask him, Adam, where are you? As if he didn't see him. That means you are in deep trouble. When God begins to ask you such questions, Adam, where are you? Even though he was seeing him. The second thing after Adam responded that I heard your voice and I was afraid because I was naked. The same voice that Adam heard 24 hours before, days upon days, because God came down at the cool of the day. He came down every evening, shared fellowship with Adam. And Adam enjoyed his fellowship and enjoyed the voice of the Lord. The same voice, the same sound within 24 hours of the fall and disobedience of man became terrifying. The sonorous voice, the healing and cooling voice became a terror to the depraved mind, the fallen nature. And God asked them the second question. Who told you you're naked? As if God was not there listening to the conversation of the devil through the serpent to the woman and then the woman to Adam. And God was asking, who told you? Who told you that you are naked? Because that didn't have to bother him. For the two of them were naked and they were not ashamed. It didn't have to bother them because the glory of the Lord was what they saw in both in each other and not the nakedness. They looked at themselves, they saw themselves, they were not blind. So now, who told them? Who gave them a different message? Like Paul says, if anybody preaches any other message to you, even if it's an angel, any message other than the one that we have preached to you concerning Jesus, the Lord and the Savior of the earth, let that person be accursed, removed, destroyed, put apart for punishment, for devastation. Because what you have said is you've called God a liar to preach any other message other than the message that Christ is the Lord and Savior of the universe, that he died for our sins, and his coming back as the reigning Savior, as the triumphant Lord. And you preach another message other than that, because of your belly, even as a man of a woman of God, because of the large congregation that you want as a church, as a people, you preach another message, you will be taken aside, accursed, separated for damnation, and then cursed also, may never be, may never recover. Because what you have done is to call God a liar, to say he didn't mean it that way. Who told you? God asks the question as if they didn't know who told him. That means Adam was in deep trouble. When God acts as if he did not know. And the devil, who had told them the lie, when he was talking to Sister Eve and saying, did God tell you not to eat of all the fruits or in the garden? And she said, God didn't say all. We can eat everything here except the one that carries the knowledge of evil and good. The tree that carries the knowledge of evil and good. Take note of that. And we will get back to that scripture and go into a few other things and revelations that God is placing upon my heart for our restoration, our healing, our recovery, and the power of the living God. And you know what happened? The serpent was possessed by the devil. And the devil spoke through the serpent saying, God, you will surely not die. God knows that if you eat of that fruit, you will be like God. You will be able to see, and you will be like him. I often ask myself, did he not create us in his image and in his likeness, his form and his holiness, not in the physical stature? We were like him, created in his likeness. And now the devil was saying, it is until we eat the fruit before we would know and be like God. What a lie. And when he was saying that they will not die, he was saying to them that when God said, the day you eat of the fruit, that day you will die. That means God lied to Adam. That's what the devil was saying. And that's why whoever says any other thing different from what we preach, what the Lord wants, and he said, and is in his scripts, his word, that person, even if he's an angel, and you know that Lucifer is an angel and a fallen one for that matter, he will be accursed, separated for destruction. He lied. Even to the 2/3 of angels in heaven to make them fall when he made them believe that he will take his throne above the throne of God. He lied to them. He must have promised them so many other things. He lied to them. What God didn't say he was, he proclaimed to them that he was that. So he is accursed eternally. Adam, where are you? As if God didn't know. Who told you you were naked? And every time God asks questions as if he doesn't know, you are in trouble, especially if it concerns your disobedience. So why would you eat the tree of the knowledge of evil and good? Like I would always say it, it carried the knowledge of evil and good. Whereas the knowledge that man possessed before eating the fruit with the knowledge of evil and good was not good knowledge, but it was God's knowledge and good and perfect knowledge. That's why when God created man and created animals, he brought all the animals to Adam to name them. And all the names that Adam gave to them, they were the names in the very heart of God, the very mind of God to give to the animals. He never made a mistake, because when God breathed into man, after molding the dust and creating man, and he breathed into his nostrils, he breathed at that time, and man became a living soul, he breathed into him his own essence, his nature, his attribute. What I do as God, begin to do it. And Adam was able to name the animals as he drew the mind of God from the breath of God in him. So he knew and he possessed perfect knowledge. And now he is falling from perfect to good knowledge. What do you need good knowledge for when you already possess perfect knowledge? And that's how we make a mess of our faith, and wreck our faith and wreck our lives, our marriages, our callings, our giftings, our graces, all because we now see the good and we abandon the perfect. You know, when we were in school and up till now, you know, it's written in English, good, better, best. Good, better, best. When you have good, it's below better. When you have better things, it's below the best. Even the best may not be perfect. So what God initially gave to man was not just the best knowledge. No, he gave him God knowledge, perfect. So man fell now. Man left the perfect knowledge and took hold of what I would call the good. And now it carries its cousin along, evil and good knowledge. So evil cousin followed the good boy, the good knowledge. And from that time, we lost the form of God. We lost the glory of God. So why would you and I forsake the perfect knowledge? When I hear this adage that whoever wants to dine with the devil must have a long spoon, I laugh. It's to portray something about how you must relate with the devil, how much you must be watchful. That's, I understand that. But let me look at it literally. If you have a long spoon and you want to dine and eat with the devil, and because you know what he can do, in order for him not to grab your hand, so you put the spoon in the plate and you take it back because you're taking it from a distance. And so you can watch if the devil wants to jump at you, you can quickly run away. And you're taking the food from the table and the plate and eating. Don't you know, whether with a short or a long spoon, why must you dine with the devil? Don't you know if you're eating with anybody, two people are eating from the same plate, gradually you touch your saliva, the saliva from the person's spoon that comes into the plate to scoop the plate or scoop anything from that place, touches it a little bit gradually. So A lot of people have been licking the spittle of the devil by dining with the devil, whether with a short or with a long spoon. Must you dine with the devil, for goodness sake? Can you partake of the table of the Lord and then partake of the table of demons? Why compromise? What do you need to compromise for? When he's giving you perfect knowledge, perfect table, perfect dinner, perfect feasting, all the food in the garden, except that one. Is it that one that he separated, that he didn't want us to get closer to? That's the one enticing us. And then the devil lied to us that from that time our eyes will be open. We were not blind, but both of them were naked, but they were not ashamed because they were seeing glory. So how did the devil say, when they eat it, their eyes will be open? And the Bible says, when the woman saw, she looked at the fruit, saw that it was good and pleasing to the eyes. She wasn't blind before she ate it, so she could see the fruit. Knew that the fruit was pleasing to the eyes, pleasant to the eyes, and good for eating. She could see it. So how will the devil now tell you that when you eat it, that's when you'll be able to see, your eyes will be open? What a lie. And you believe that. So God now said, I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and Christ. Prophetically is spoken of there. And the seed of the serpent, the devil, his demons, and the sin that he will continue to put people in, and then he will strike the heel of Christ. And that was done on the cross of Calvary. And Christ was bruised on the cross. And you know, the heel represents the preparation of the gospel of peace, according to the book of Ephesians, that chapter 6, that we should shod our feet after putting on the helmet of salvation. Then we shod our feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. And then it says, you know, how beautiful on the mountaintop are the feet of those who bring good news. So the feet represents goodness. And so you see that the area where the devil is attacking mostly today is the gospel of Christ, the truth of Christ that we proclaim. Is bruising, is attacking it, so that people will not believe that truth. For when we know the truth, according to John chapter 8, book of John chapter 8, verse number 32, we shall be made free. And verse 36, and he who the Son makes free shall be free indeed. So that freedom indeed, that liberty, that emancipation from the hand of the devil, he doesn't want you to have it. So you only have it when you know the truth. And Jesus says, John 14, 6, he is the way, the truth, and the life. And so he wants to crush that gospel as he has attacked Jesus. But then the gospel will be raised a foot higher, and he will crush the head of Satan. Hallelujah, somebody. A decree over somebody's life here. In every area where the enemy is bruising you and striking you, you will rise above in the power of the Holy Ghost, and you will crush the devil underneath your feet. All the scorpions and serpents attacking your destiny and your glory, you will rise above them. You will crush them in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. So now man fell because of disobedience. And this keeps happening. And we see it over and over up till this time. And so this great man of God, Jeremiah, that is like a study case here, and many other men of God in the Bible, be it Joel the prophet or Isaiah the prophet, even Moses, and coming into the New Testament, our Lord Jesus Christ, the Savior himself, then the apostles that he chose in Matthew chapter 10, and he empowered them, and they from being disciples, they became apostles, and he empowered them and sent them out, commanding them to go preach the gospel in the entire world, making disciples of all nations, according to Matthew 28, and teaching the people to observe and to obey all that he has commanded us. That which is the Great Commission, all those great men and our own contemporary evangelists and prophets today, two things may happen that can put us in some trouble. And then God will come and rescue and then restores. One is the sin, like that of Adam. And we need mercy. We need to acknowledge that sin. We need God to open our eyes to know that we have erred, we've fallen from grace, and we need to be rescued. Just as when David, a type of Christ, was keeping the flock, he said a bear came. That was part of his testimony when he wanted to fight Goliath. And they looked at him and said, Goliath has been fighting from when he was a teenager. But you're just a lad. He said, when I was tending the flock and a bear came and took one of the sheep, I ran after it. And he wouldn't have run after it if he was not a true shepherd. He didn't fear for his life. He knew his assignment as a shepherd. And that's how those of you listening to me should know your calling and your assignment as ministers, as the called of Christ to the generation that you belong to. He went after it. And he delivered, he rescued. Imagine the sheep within the jaws and being held tightly by the teeth of the bear. And then David grabbed the sheep. If you look at it logically, the sheep should be torn apart because the bear too will struggle to keep what he has seen as his meal for the day. And he rescued. That's how God is able to rescue anyone in the claws and the jaws of the devil. And then when the bear turned to attack the rescuer, the deliverer, the agent of restoration. So the Spirit of God came upon him and he tore the bear as if he was tearing a piece of paper. And the same thing when a lion came, did exactly what the bear did and took one of the sheep. David, the shepherd boy, a type of Christ, went after the lion, delivered, rescued the sheep. And when the lion came after the shepherd boy, then the lion of the tribe of Judah, the lion of lions, just as is the king of kings and the lord of lords, the lion of lions, the lion above lions, the lion of the tribe of Judah, pounced on the evil lion and toyed to pieces. The rescue came. So when we sin, when we disobey God, and he keeps warning us, God will be patient with us, and that patience sometimes deceives us. That's why when prophets give prophecies and they see that it has not happened immediately, people will say, yeah, there he goes, he's lied. it will happen immediately. But God is patient to see, he wants us to get saved. And we now take that for granted and believe that's a lie. And we continue in our sin. And he could wait for decades. But when he strikes with judgment, there may not be remedy. So, and sometimes when the sin of the disobedient is being punished, the righteous will feel it because you are in the system. We are in the world together. We are in the same city, in the same state, in the same country together. And we are obeying God, they are disobeying. And when destruction is coming, we may feel, and that's why you find people like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and Daniel going into exile, not because of their sin, but because of the sin of the people that they lived with. The same thing, Jeremiah, the prophet, was in the dungeon for preaching the truth. And when captivity came, he was imprisoned again and again. But you see that Jeremiah never compromised. Every time Zedekiah asked him, what does the Lord say? He will tell him exactly what the Lord wants him to do to surrender to the Babylonians. If you try to escape, you will be punished. You will die. If you try to compromise with Egyptian king and not go the way the Lord wants you to go, even though you are going to be a slave in his hand, but your life will be spared. You will not die. But if you don't, you will die and all the people will die. So we take God for granted. We believe that his gentleness with us, even when some people call it slowness, is a weakness. And so we do whatever we like. But he's only giving us room for repentance. And that's how restoration or rescue can come if we are able to repent. Repentance brings the rescue. And after you rescued, then restoration will follow. I will come to that briefly, but I need to clear this. So on one side, the trouble comes because of the sin of the people, our personal or national sin. And then trouble can come because of you playing your role as a Christian in a perverse generation. You'll be hated, you'll be persecuted, there'll be opposition, they can stone you, they can kill you. It's not because of your sin, it's because of your loyalty to God. It's because of your truthfulness to the service of the kingdom. And some of you are worried sometimes. You want everybody to like you. If you understand Genesis chapter 3, there will always be enmity between your seed and the seed of the devil. It's going to be eternal. So why do you want everybody to like you? Why do you want everybody to like your church? Why do you want everybody to like your music? Why do you want everybody to believe your gospel? Why do you want everybody to smile at you and love you? There is an enmity pronounced between the seed of the woman. And so when God gives you those who can believe in you, praise him. When God gives you those who can love you and accept you, thank him for that. And keep that. Hold on to it. But if you want to gather those who don't like you with those who like you, and you want everybody to like you, you will crush yourself. You will have brain hemorrhage. You will bleed in your head. Because you can't go against the prophecy. There will be enmity between the seed of the woman and the seed of the serpent. It will be forever. So some will take you and love you. Some will reject you. Are you bothered about those who reject you? Or you should be bothered about them not accepting the message that can deliver them from eternal destruction and damnation? Now, take note of this again. You are being bruised because of your loyalty to Christ. You're being bruised because of your truth that the world does not want to accept. They don't want that pleasure that they desire, whether it's evil or is the temporary pleasure, their comfort zone to be addressed or touched. People want to dress anyhow, half naked, naked. Some people want to talk anyhow with fast way. So correction, truthful guidance, they will loathe that. They will hate that. And because they hate that, the proclaimer too will be hated. So do you want to compromise and sugarcoat your message because the people don't want to accept it? Go ahead. You go ahead and sugarcoat it and see whether the people will still not turn their back on you someday. And by the time you have sugarcoated the message and compromised faith, and the same people you think you are pleased turn around to bite you. The one who is able to save you and rescue you, you have turned your back on him. You will have no savior, and no deliverer, no rescuer for your life. So for you who has been faithful, you've been steadfast, you've been loyal. Because of your loyalty, God will restore to you all the things that you have lost. Trouble has bruised you. He will restore to you. He will heal you again. But for those who are not loyal, who are not faithful, when they repent, then God will rescue them and he will restore to them. So the faithful one is that your truthfulness and faithfulness and loyalty that will bring your own restoration. To the unfaithful and to the disobedience, it is repentance that will bring your own restoration. There are two different things here. But let me emphasize this. And you know that in the scriptures, when God said he will restore to us the years that the cankerworm and the palmer worms have eaten, let me give us an idea of how the devourer. If you look at the book of Joel, chapter 1, verse number 4, it says, what the locust swarm has left, the great locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, the young locusts have eaten. What the great locusts have left, other locusts have eaten. This is it. I love to watch the animal kingdom, wildlife. And I see sometimes a lion gets its prey, kills the prey, or it's a bear, or and then it eats what it can eat. And maybe leaves the rest or buries it. When the lion has taken hold of the bull and eaten what it can eat, and it leaves a remnant, the vultures are swarming around, or you have some other jackals and the hyenas waiting to take what is called the leftover. And when they eat what they can eat from what the lion has left over, then the vultures will take that, or the hyenas will take that, and then some bones and pieces will also be left, and some maggots will come and eat that, and sometimes some termites will come and feed until there is nothing left. So what the locust left, then you'll find some canker worms and some palmer worms too will devour theirs until, so the devourer would take everything, and it's the least, the devourer is the least of all these eaters that will swarm on those who have been going against the will and the way of God. But do you know God says, no matter how they have devoured, if you are still in my will, I will restore to you those years that have been wasted. And even you, if you repent, you're a sinner, you're wayward, you've gone the wrong way, God says, I can restore to you all those pieces. Wherever you've been scattered, the Lord used that several times concerning the people of Israel. I will gather you back. They've taken all the bits, and that can be proven with what happened in the Valley of Dry Bones with his servant Ezekiel. The bones were very dry and they were scattered all over the place. Erosion has taken them away. But when God said, prophesy, broken bones parted away, scattered all over, dry, began to come from the four corners of the earth as the wind began to blow from the four corners of the earth. And bone to bone, sinews to sinews, and marrow to marrow, and head to the neck and to the trunk. And that which was scattered was gathered. God is able to restore you. And in closing tonight, a decree over your life in every area where you've missed it, where you've misstepped. God will rescue you. And then he will restore you, because what he wants for you and I is that our emancipation from our Egypt is for us to serve him. Let my people go that they may serve me. We are for his service. We are following his script. You know, when they do drama, there is a script. And that script must be followed. You must play your role at one, scene two, scene one, scene two. You play your role. If you want to play some other thing that is not in the script, you confuse others. You are out of place. So the script is where you get the scripture, the holy writ of God. And when you play your role in the unfolding drama of God's redemption, then you will be blessed the way God wants you to be blessed. But if you don't want to follow the script, that is the scripture, where you also have the scribes, the writers of the scripts, and the scriptures now that we call the holy writings, the holy writ of God, then you'll be out of place. So I pray that where you are not following your own role, that God will restore you. God will place you back. Some of you missed it because you want people, you want to please everybody. You want everybody to like you, everybody to love you, everybody to follow the way you want. There's enmity between your seed, the seed of the woman. I decree over your life today that you will find your place and you will fulfill your purpose and destiny in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. I want to thank you again, Pastor Ajay, and all the leadership of Christ Apostolic Church House of Prayer. Thank you so much for your love, for your honor, for your invitation. Thank you for bringing me up to be part of your 2022 prayer conference. Thank you all for listening and for sharing the message. Don't forget this, that Jesus is coming back very soon. No matter how you do it, if you don't play your role, if you don't follow the holy writ, the script of God's drama of redemption, you'll be out of place. And may God not let you misstep. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Can I hear a big hallelujah? I can't hear you online or at home or in the auditorium. Can I hear a big hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
Thank you very much, Pastor. Don't go yet. We're trying to get some few questions gathered together so we can.
I'm with you.
Just if okay.
I'm with you.
God bless you, sir. Thank you very much. Okay. Yeah. Do we have questions
online?
Okay.
Then we'll proceed with the program. Deacon, I will go ahead if there's any questions online.
Yes, that's what I was confirming. There's not been any question in the chat yet. I have one particular question. I just wanted Pastor to help us to shed more light. And like you rightly noted, if one had fallen as a result of sin, and yeah. you've made your way back to God, you're still guaranteed those rights. What about those who is at the point of death that eventually try to make their way back? What happens to them? Praise the Lord. And we also have one question online, but I'll let you quickly answer that. What happens if it is those who finally make their way back at the point of death?
All right. What we are looking at is that at the point of death, if they make their way back to Jesus, number one, let's look at the scenario at the cross where you had two thieves. Dying on the cross, being crucified for their sins. And one was there on the cross and still speaking evil about Jesus. If you are truly the Son of God. So he had heard something about Jesus. And he said, you just save yourself and save us. Now that salvation day is, we'll break away, run away, and then we'll go and continue stealing and doing the rubbish that we've been doing. But we need to get out from the cross. We need your power if you are truly. So he didn't believe him. You call yourself the Son of God. But the other one said, you know, we are dying. We're being punished for what we did wrong. But for this man, that one too had heard something about Jesus. He said, it's not about his own sin. He's not suffering because of his sin. He's suffering to fulfill the purpose of the Lord Almighty. And the Lord said, today you shall be with me in paradise, because he believed him. So he didn't have any time to be baptized, to be water baptized, but no one can call Jesus Lord except by the Spirit. So the Spirit of the Lord had taken over his heart because he believed. And no time for him to preach the gospel to the people in the world, but he preached Jesus to the next thief on the cross. He still proclaimed him. So he was the first to get into paradise. Even before all of that, he did proclaim Jesus. He accepted Jesus. He proclaimed him, but he didn't have a time to go out on the street and conduct a great crusade and hold Zoom meetings, but he proclaimed Jesus. And so at the last moment of any man's life, salvation can be gotten. You may not have now the time to do many works so that you can have rewards and have so many stars on your crown because you didn't give your life to him early enough and you didn't have much time or much years to get to do, because we're going to be rewarded for our works apart from our salvation. So you may be saved and your reward for your works may not be as much as the person who had many more years to accept the Lord and to walk with him. So you can, at the last minute, accept the Lord. Salvation is first, it's key, that you don't even go to hell at all. So, because finding yourself in hell, even with those who have walked and walked and walked and walked, Paul said at the last moment, after I've done this, I don't want to be a castaway, because it's possible for you to labor for 40 years, 30 years, then you lose your soul, your works, all the people you preach to and saved and healed will be in heaven. So it's best that you get saved first. And then we'll talk about reward later if you have years to live and to work and to serve him. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. There's one question from one of the listeners, and it actually dovetails into the one we've just asked. It says, Is it everyone who will be restored here on earth, or will some people get theirs in heaven? This is with respect to the loyal Christians who have been bruised because of their loyalty.
Is it everyone that will get what?
Is it everyone who will be restored here on earth?
Restored. Okay, now I get it. You know, Jesus promised his disciples when they asked him, we have left everything to follow you. What's going to be our reward? He first started by saying that those of you who have left father, you've left mother, you've left parents, you've left your house and everything, it says that you will be rewarded here on earth, even though it will even come with some persecution. You'll be rewarded here and in the eternal life to be. So let's assume that a father struggled to serve the Lord and he did all that he could do. And it's like he didn't enjoy most of his years on earth, just like Jeremiah, that the Lord said he knew before he was formed in his mother's womb. As a teenager, he began to serve the Lord and he suffered for more than 30 years. Preaching the gospel, being tortured, being put in prison. And now imagine such a person being compensated by the Lord, by God giving him children on earth who will now serve the Lord because he has paved the way for them. And they will do things and it will look like this one just enjoy. No, that's part of the reward of the father who labored, who suffered for Christ on earth. The Lord will reward him. Don't forget Hebrews chapter 11, verse 6 says, people must come to God, must first of all believe that God exists. And that God is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. He will reward you here on earth. He can bless your children and children's children after you are gone. Don't forget somebody like Isaiah, 850 years after he had preached that Christ will be born through a virgin, was when the word was fulfilled. It was fulfilled here on earth. He had died 850 years. So God will reward even those that belong to you, that come out from your loins. Did Abraham walk into the land of promise? No, but he was rewarded that even up till today, where he is, he knows that everyone is in Abraham, has many sons has father Abraham, and Abraham's blessings are mine. He's been rewarded, he was rewarded on earth. God told him he will have his children will fill the entire earth. He didn't see that because God told him that he will go to his father in peace, but his offspring would be in a slave land for 400 years. And after 400 years that he will bring them out. So the reward will still come here on earth. Then the eternal one is when you will know that you did not labor in vain, that you did not miss it. You served the Lord and his will was fulfilled in your life. When you now live with Christ in glory, and not regret, and not even feel the pain and the torture and the persecution and opposition anymore. You know that you are now being crowned for all your labor, for the losses that you might have counted while you were on earth. You have the glories, not just glory, glories, plural now in heaven. Amen.
Amen. Thank you very much, Pastor. I think that's the end of our question. I'll hand over to the Glasgow Church to continue proceedings. God bless you.
We want to appreciate our Father. There are a few questions here before we let our daddy go.
All right.
There are a few questions. Please, let's put our daddy on the screen.
I'm with you.
Let's spotlight on him. Yes. Deacon Ernest, who are those that have the questions? Yes, Lady Evangelist Okafor is raising her hand.
Praise the Lord.
Lady Evangelist.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Thank you very much, our daddy. We really enjoyed the training, the lecture, sir. My question is around your comment about likability. I completely agree with what you have said. You know, there's enmity between the seed of the woman and the seed of the devil. But you find out that even Christians, when you do not want to be liked by people, as you have recommended, you find out that even Christians will begin to preach as much as it lies with you, strive to be at peace with all men and all of that, pursue peace with all men, you know, and you find yourself stuck between, I really should do this, and this is what the Holy Spirit has told me, or this is what God says. But in my workplace, in school, even sometimes in church, you find yourself, because you're social, you want people to like you, you find yourself falling. So what are practical steps to managing or striking a good balance, sir? Thank you, sir.
Right. I heard of a man, I don't remember his name now. I was just going through a book, and then I saw it. And he said, if you want everybody to like you, go and sell ice cream. I love that statement. If you want everybody to like you, be selling ice cream, because everybody likes ice cream. Children want ice cream. The elderly ones want ice cream once in a while. And that's it's led us to compromise our faith. That's why we, now, I would say, be at peace with all men, that God is saying, does not mean that you sell your birthright. It does not mean that you put your God in a corner and take the idol and what the world worships just because you want. Now, do you know what the devil did? The way he tempted Adam and Eve, he did the same, he used the same strategy for Jesus in Matthew chapter 4. He, you know, don't forget the lust of the eyes that you will find in 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 to 17. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For if any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is of the world, the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride display of life, those were the same strategy, the same points that he used for Adam and Eve. They saw the fruit. Adam saw, Sister Eve saw the fruit. It was pleasing to the eyes, good for food. In the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride display of life, I will be like God and my eyes will be open. He said the same thing to Jesus. He said, the food, now that you are hungry, command these stones to become bread. The pride that you can use your power to do anything, the pride of life, that, but the lust of the flesh was there. Then he also said, come to the pinnacle. Now jump from this place. He made him then. Thirdly, that's where I'm going now. He said to him, see, he showed him all the glories of the world. But he asked him, you bow, let me control your destiny. I will give you a car, but I will hold on to the keys of the car. I will give you a house, the glories of the world, but I will give you, I will take the key, the control system, the control button will be in my hand. Whenever I want you to sleep is when you will sleep. He said, but you bow, give me your authority. And these are the things that we do in the world. We are like politicians now who will promise you this, but they already know from the beginning that they are not going to fulfill what they say because they are politicians. They are not leaders. They can be rulers, but they are not leaders. Leaders don't do that. So many Christians have turned out to be politicians. Many Christians have taken on to the spirit of this age. And they want everybody to like them. But you, I will say to you, I recommend to you, be friendly with everybody, but not everybody will be your friend. There's a difference between you being friendly with people, greet them, like them, love them, bless them, open your door to them, be good to them. You are fulfilling the word of God. But when you now want to get them to yourself alone, and it's you you want to pose before them, not the Lord, not the gospel, you will get it wrong because people are deceptive. Praise the Lord.
The last question. Hallelujah. Okay, there's, I think that is all, sir. We want to appreciate you. We want to thank you for taking out time to, you know, out of your busy schedule. Yeah, I know you're a very busy person. So we appreciate you for taking the lecture, and we are blessed. Hallelujah. How many of us are blessed today? Hallelujah.
Thank you so much. We are blessed. It's my delight. Thank you. God bless you.
And the anointing of God upon your life will not run dry in Jesus' name. Let's take time to pray for him. Let's stretch our hands to the screen. Let's pray for our Father. Pastor Anu Ojo. Let's pray for him. Let's tell God to bless him as he has watered us this evening and we have learned. We have been blessed. Let the Lord also bless him where he is, his home, his ministry, everything that concerns him. Are you praying? Lord, we pray that you bless him abundantly. As he has watered us this evening, Lord, we pray that anointing will be refilled upon his life. Let a new dew of anointing be upon him. Thank you, everlasting Father. Lord, be with him, be with his home, his ministry, everything that concerns him. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, everlasting Father. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed.
Amen.
And the people of God say, without wasting much time, I'll call on our Father in the Lord, who will take prayers, Pastor David Aruaji, the resident pastor of the Edinburgh Church. Pastor Aruaji, please. Can we give God a round of applause?
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We have been blessed by our daddy this evening. What a wonderful word that God has sent to us this moment. We are not taking it for granted. Thank you so much, sir, for coming to be a blessing to us. As a church, we are also going to pray for our daddy. I would like us to rise up to our feet as we are going to pray in this just few minutes. You know, it's a very good thing for us to pray for the men of God. Because being a man of God and a preacher is a big burden that he carries. So it involves so many challenges, so many struggles in it. Immediately that they release the mind of God to us, the devil is always on guard or on his way to try to fight back. So what we can do to them or what we can do for them is to support them in prayer. Hallelujah. So I want to encourage you as you are praying for our Father in the Lord all the way from Nigeria, that blessing will be coming back to you as well in the name of Jesus. First, I want us to thank God for sending this servant to us today. I want us to bless God for sending him to us today, for preparing him to come and bless us today. In his own way, in God's own way. Let's begin to thank God for that, for his life. Let's thank God for the ministry that God has committed unto his hand. I want you to thank God for that. Give him praise. Give God a praise on behalf of our Father, Pastor Anu Ojo, for God has sent him to be a blessing to CAC House of Prayer United Kingdom today. And everybody that have been partakers of this conference, day one of this conference, what a wonderful message that God is going to restore us indeed. Why can't you thank God for that message? Why can't you thank God for the servant of God? Give glory to his name. In Jesus' name, we are praying. I would like us to pray for him, that God will make him to feel encouraged. We cannot give him much, but we can pray that God will make him to feel encouraged, that God will encourage him the more, that God will encourage his ministry. His ministry will not go down. Even after this ministration, that God will restore him in every area. Let's begin to pray that prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for your servant that you will encourage him. In the name of Jesus, encourage him, encourage him, encourage him. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, we pray as a church. We gather together, we are praying as your church for your servants. Lord, you will encourage him. In the name of Jesus, in Jesus' name, we are praying. I want us to pray the third prayer. You're going to pray and say, Lord, You will make him to find joy and fulfillment in doing the will of God. Lord, make your servant to find joy and fulfillment in doing your will. Let's begin to pray that prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for your servant. You will cause him to find joy. He will not be in sorrow after this message. He will not be in pain after this message. He will find fulfillment that he has released your word unto us. In Jesus' name, we are praying. The last prayer we are going to pray for him, and we'll pray one for ourselves. We are going to pray for him and say, Lord, refuel his spirit. After he has released the word to us tonight, refuel his spirit. Rekindle your fire in him. Let's lift up our voice and pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for your servant, our daddy in the Lord, Pastor Anojo, that you will refuel his spirit, rekindle your fire in him more than before, that he will remember this message that he preached for hours of prayer for better. He will remember today that he ministered to us for better, that things of good that has never happened to him before will begin to happen to him. In Jesus' name, we are praying. Us to pray this one for ourselves. The man of God said he was making an illustration of David while he was rescuing a very young sheep from the mouth of the bears. And he got to a stage, he said, that is what happened when Jesus is taking us from the mouth of the devil. And the devil will also be dragging back. I was imagining in my mind that there's going to be a bruise. There's going to be so many things. I wanted to ask a question. Can we get total restoration with that bruises that we got? I want you to pray. Lord, if there's any bruises in my life, because I was once in the hand of the devil, rescue me tonight. So many things that many Christian children of God are facing today is because of the bruises of the enemies. Lord, rescue me tonight. Restore me totally. Restore my spirit. Restore my soul. Restore my body. Restore my mind. Restore me. Let there be no traces of bruises. Let there be no traces of bruises in my life again. Come to me in a new way, in a new dimension. In the name of Jesus, I have submitted unto you. I have given myself to you. I have given my time to you. I have submitted it unto you. I want you to begin to confess it now. I submit everything. I give it unto you. Thank you, Jesus. Sing this song now. Your challenges. Father, in the name of Jesus, we return the glory unto you tonight for the day one of this conference. We thank you because you started well with us. When our father in the Lord, the senior pastor, was giving a opening message, the Spirit of God was in this place. The presence of God was mighty in this place. We thank you because you started well with us. We thank you because the remaining days is going to be a glorious one. Father, we return the glory unto you in the name of Jesus. Every petition that we have laid into your hand tonight, Father, answer us speedily and quickly in the name of Jesus Christ. And let us come back here tomorrow with testimonies. In Jesus' name, we are praying. Can you put your hands together and celebrate Jesus?
Hallelujah. Let's be seated.
in the presence of the Lord. Hallelujah. Are you blessed this night? Yes, we are blessed. I will hand over to, it's time for offering. And the person that will take the offering is no other person than Pastor Timothy Adika, our resident pastor in Derby. Please, let's switch to him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Praise Master Jesus. Can you hear me? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh, that's great. God bless you. My prayer is that we'll finish well in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We want to thank God for our Father for bringing such a wonderful vessel. Daddy, God bless you. And our Father that God have used to bless us, we pray for more grace in the name of Jesus Christ. It's our offering time. Those in the auditorium, I want you to package your offering. Those online, the media can help us display the account number. But I want us to look, let's turn our Bible to Genesis. Genesis chapter 8, from verse 21. Let me take it from 20. And the Bible says, "And Noah builded an ark, an altar unto the Lord, and he took of every clean beast and every clean fowl, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savour, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground anymore for man's sake, for the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite anymore everything living as I've done. 22, the Bible says, while the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest and cold and heat and summer and winter and day and night shall not cease." I want to tell you, if you must make it, there's a principle. Some of us, we are only heavenly conscious and earthly useless. Let me tell you, if you are not a giver, you have nothing in the heavenly bank. Paul prayed for them when the Philippians prayed and blessed him. He said, "My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." So because of a man's giving, the Lord said, "I avert curse. I've averted this." Tonight I pray your offering will avert every curse in your life in the name of Jesus Christ. So seed time is very key. Before you enjoy harvest, seed time. And therefore be intentional about your offering. I want you to package a good offering. If you must deposit in the heavenly bank, because it comes as a reward. When you deposit, if you send your offering, you know, to do the work of God as a gift to his work, I want to tell you, a reward comes, so that will not be earthly useless. You know, not like some people are just heavenly conscious and they are earthly useless. Offering is a part of offering. I mean, you're part of worship. You know, so I want us to be intentional. Can we do that quickly? Send your offering. I want those in the auditorium, just package your offering and while we pray over it. I want you to package it, and those online can now send it. Can you raise your offering, those in the auditorium? I want you to raise your offering. Lift it up as I pray, because as you offer, Father, we thank you, Lord. We give you praise. You are awesome. I stand on your word. I said, seed time and harvest. Father, today, as your children give to your work, as your children freely give, Father, I pray, good measures, pressed down, shaking together, running over, shall men give unto their bosom. Lord, I pray, their barn shall be filled. Every empty barn tonight, by their giving Holy Spirit, I command a filling now. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command a multiplication. I command replenishment. I command increase by the power in the name of Jesus. Father, I thank you, Lord. Thank you, Abba Father, for doing it. Take all the glory. May your name be glorified. For in Jesus' mighty name, we have prayed. Amen. You can cast your offering right now. Go ahead. God bless you. Man of God, Pastor Kafo, hand over to you.
What am I blessed? What am I blessed? He has done my balance place for me. What am I blessed? What am I blessed? Is it doing my balance things for me? I'm blessed. Those things that money can't buy are the things that Jesus did for me. What my father cannot do, what the money cannot buy, he has done it again and again. Omnipotent God, omniscient God, omniscient, everything is your name. What a marvelous God. What have I lost? Is it doing my lost things?
Should we continue to dance? I didn't want that song to finish, actually. Let me confess. Should we go ahead? Some people want to go home so that we can come back tomorrow. Hallelujah. Let's be seated quickly as we take our announcements. The first announcement I will take is that tomorrow is another day. Hallelujah. Tomorrow is another day, and we'll be starting same time by 6 p.m. I want you to do some form of publicity for this program tomorrow. Please ensure you invite 5 people to the program tomorrow. How many people did I say? 5 people. You don't have any issues with going to force them to come here. Just tell them about the program and let God do the rest. Hallelujah. Do you believe in God? You believe in his power? Yes. Just inform 5 people. That is what the mind of the Lord is telling me. Inform 5 people. Don't go and drag them. Just inform them of the program. It shall be well with you in Jesus' name. It shall be well with you in Jesus' name. There's an important announcement from the ushering department with respect to the emergency exits. We need to notify us of emergency exits and where our toilet is. So there's one emergency exit to my right side here. Can we see the door? Then there's one to this side as well. Hallelujah. And then we have our toilets behind. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So please, let's use our toilets very well. Don't let us mess it up. When you are done, clean, you know, after use, it shall be well with us in Jesus' name. I think that's... So at this point in time, we'll take the closing hymn. So I'll call on the choir to come and lead us in the closing hymn. Thank you.
Can we be on our feet as we sing our closing hymn for this prayer conference? We shall be singing our hymn 568, You Are My Friend, John 15:14. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins are grieved to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer.
praise the Lord. Hallelujah. A better hallelujah, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We want to give all glory to the name of the Lord for the success of the first day of this conference. And we believe you have been blessed. Amen. Yeah. I pray that the blessings of this first day shall be permanent in your life in Jesus' name. Yeah. Just before we go, we want to also recognize the presence of all our fathers and our mothers that are connecting with us on Zoom and all our social media. We appreciate your coming. May the Lord bless you all in the name of Jesus. Don't forget, the second day also starts tomorrow morning, 6 a.m., during our morning due. Pastor Kafo did not say that. That is part of conference. Amen. When we are having a conference like this, it's a 24-hour prayer. And also, if you want to come to the church to pray, let us know. The church will be open for you. Amen. It's a time of intercession. It's a time of prayer. Make sure even personally you are praying. Amen. Wake up in the midnight and pray. And I pray the Lord will hear you in the name of Jesus. Let's just pray to the Lord and just say, Father, I thank you for the blessing that you have given me tonight. I said, go, let your presence go with me. Let your grace go with me in the name of Jesus. Can we have our watchword? Amen. I pray that every blessing that we receive shall go with us in Jesus' name. The grace of the Lord will be sufficient for us in the name of Jesus. In this conference, your own will be possible in the name of Jesus. There shall be testimony in your home in the name of Jesus. So shall it be. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we say our watchword together? But you be strong and do not let your hand be weak, for your work shall be rewarded. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. 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 In Jesus' name. Surely his goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen. God bless you and have a lovely night. Amen.